because there's another group that's coming in here at 11, so we need to be out by 11. Exactly. So we will. I'm Sandy Dressler. I am the former COO of Team Punta Gorda. I just resigned after 3 years because it was too much. It was taking my life. But I am still chair of the community garden along with Carol Moore. And we also have another person, but she's not here yet, Martha Lindquist. So we started the garden a couple years ago. If you go there now, it's a mess. Everything got shifted when Irma came through. We had planned to have all of our soil delivered 3 days before the hurricane. We had to cancel that. We had planned on people who just didn't finish cleaning up their garden, taking care of all that, but then we all left. And so we're a little bit behind the ball right now, but we plan on getting everything done very soon. If you are interested, this afternoon at 3 o'clock is our History Park Community Garden Committee meeting. The committee is the group of people who make all the decisions about the garden, how things are gonna be run, what we need to do. We're gonna get a work group together, and we do have, thank God, some kids who are willing to help us to do some work in there. We are gonna have the soil delivered. Becky Copenhagen takes care of that. We're gonna have our soil and our mulch delivered. It'll be your responsibility. We've got wheelbarrows to take care of your own plot. The other thing I wanted to explain to you is that because the garden is a community garden, the whole garden is your responsibility, not the individual plots. But like if you see weeds starting to grow, because that is something that we are just struggling with constantly. If you see weeds, pull them. If you see garbage, throw it in the garbage. You know, we're just trying to keep it as nice as possible. We do have a back half of the garden that the committee today will be talking about whether or not we need to expand. We still have, how many, Carol, about 40?
We have at least 40 people
waiting. At least 40 on our waiting list.
Still.
So people like it. It's a great opportunity. The other thing I wanted to tell you about was if you're interested in some organic plants, the place that I bought mine last year, I was a newbie to gardening last year, was at the Echo Global Farm out in Fort Myers. Their products are great. Everything of mine grew and grew crazy, and I didn't even know what I was doing, so it does work. And they're either going to have a sale this Saturday. They also got hit bad by Irma. So they may extend and change the sale date to 2 weeks from today. I send out like a little newsletter thing to you. So right now in your packet, I think it's on the second page, it kind of gives you some information that I had sent to the other gardeners. So if you didn't get that, please take time to read that, because it kind of tells you all the different things that are going on within the garden.
Did you buy pack seedlings or
seeds? I actually bought plants. I bought plants. A lot of people do start just with seedlings or with seeds, but not me. I was not that brave. But I'm going to turn this over to Fred, because Fred is our master gardener. He knows everything there is to know about organic gardening.
Yeah.
And I was a newbie last year, and I learned a lot from him. So I'm going to turn it over to Fred. And then we'll take questions at the end. Okay? And there are restrooms in there, and drinks and coffee and everything else you might need right there. Hi, you can sit here.
Thank you, Sandy.
You're welcome.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I have one additional handout that Sandy did not put in the packet. Everyone take a copy and just pass it around. This handout is the original vegetable garden handout from the University of Florida. And then with the advent of organic gardening, they've also prepared an organic gardening in Florida, and you have a different copy of that already in the handouts. Again, to introduce myself, my name is Fred Brown. I am a Florida master gardener, and today I'm going to be giving you an orientation on those specific requirements that are unique to organic gardening, organic vegetable gardening. As a brief overview, the vegetable gardening classes that we receive as a master gardener are 8 hours long. Two four-hour classes. There's a great amount of information on just about every topic you can imagine related to vegetable gardening. I have abbreviated this class, and the presentation will be giving you the specifics related to vegetable gardening in order to adhere to the organic gardening principles. We have a time limit here in the class today. There's another function taking place at 11, and so I will be going through the presentation fairly quickly, and I would ask that you hold your questions until about 15 minutes before the class ends, and I'll answer any questions that you have at that time. Just a quick overview. We need to understand what's the difference between ordinary vegetable gardening and organic vegetable gardening.
Thank you.
To do that, I'll be giving you an overview of organic as it is defined by the National Organic Program. And after that, we'll be discussing some garden planning, some soil preparation, planting, irrigation, fertilization, pest management, and some garden practices and maintenance. Specific emphasis today will be on pest management and on irrigation and fertilization. Those three elements are the most important in terms of adhering to organic gardening principles. Help? Oh, there we go. Sandy gave you in your handout a copy of the Organic Vegetable Gardening in Florida brochure that's prepared by the University of Florida. And I'm passing around an additional one, which was the original vegetable gardening principles in Florida. First and foremost with organic gardening is that the products that you use in your gardening need to be from a biological process. No formulated fertilizers, insecticides, pesticides, fungicides are allowed. No sevens, no malathions. Many of you, I assume, have had some gardening experience in the past, and it's the fallback if you have a pest problem to go to your local box store and buy yourself some insecticide or fungicide, etc. There are many products, and I'll discuss some of them as we go along, that are organic that you can use in lieu of using any formulated insecticide or pesticide. Repeat, no products produced by a chemical process. The basis of the product should be a natural product derived from a plant process. What we're discussing, as I said, in addition to pest management, we'll be discussing irrigation. Turns out for a gardener, one of the more important things that you really need to pay attention to. Overwaterization or underwatering will put your plants in stress, and as such, you will not be as successful in your gardening effort. use the mouse. And for some reason, I'm not getting there. Oh. Oh, sorry.
That's okay.
I have inserted into the program from what was, this originally was a PowerPoint which has been modified for organic gardening. I have included information on, well, gardening, some of the basics that Ed Gardner needs to know in order to start their experience. It'll be abbreviated. If a person has some questions regarding to the process, techniques, how to do anything related to the garden, I'll be available after we finish the presentation to answer questions. And as part of the Master Gardener Assistance for the History Park Community Organic Garden, we will be providing a Master Gardener at the garden plots on Mondays, the first Monday of each month, from 9 to 11. That Master Gardener will be there to answer any questions, any problems you may have. And we encourage you to take advantage of the person being there to help you. I myself will be there most of the time, and there will also be other Master Gardeners that will also be attending the plant clinic. We call it a plant clinic. We hold plant clinics throughout the county. And the process is quite simple. We're going to discuss some site requirements, and some of the things that we'll be discussing you already have been provided as a gardener at the History Park. Your site is identified. So we'll just quickly discuss what you have. But I'm going to just give you the general criteria for a site requirement for the situation where you may have your own possible plot where you could plant in the back of your yard, etc. I recognize that in some cases, some of you may live in a restricted community, deed restricted, or in an HOA, and as such, you may have limitations in whether you can even have a garden plot. But it's good information for you to have and keep in mind for future application. We'll discuss a little bit about how to plant, some planting times and the seasons related to plants, seed sources, and this information is all provided in the handouts that you've been given. So it'll be repetitive in that respect. I encourage you to read, especially the organic gardening handout, to read it thoroughly and to go back and refer to it as you have questions. Most of the information that you will need is provided right there. If it is not, then we have a plant clinic. You'll be able to ask questions of the Master Gardener there. And so let's proceed. I guess my thing, oh, there it comes, whoops, back. You have in your handout the Organic Vegetable Gardening handout from the University of Florida. I just passed around the Florida Vegetable Gardening Guide. My finger's not educated. Okay. Two additional guidelines that are in the website from the University of Florida. And each one of them, they're also, I think, mentioned in the handouts. But I put them up here for your information. One is a handout on plant identification of your vegetables. If you are growing a vegetable and you fail to label what you planted, that'll be a handy guide for you on identifying what vegetables you have. The other one is seed sources from Florida homegrown vegetables. And all of this is just a quote, just to give credit from where these slides are developed.
Right,
so you can also know that you're using this tool. Just use those.
Yep.
Oh, okay. One of the more important things for vegetable gardening is sun. You're very fortunate to have an excellent site at History Park where all the beds have good access to full sun. And there'll be a water source that's been provided, with the exception of one tree. I think I recall this at the park. You're away from any competing tree roots, which would tend to be absorbing much more of the moisture. Each of the beds has been well prepared. It has a mixture of excellent composted soil that is well drained, and it, generally speaking, will produce you vegetables without much in the way of fertilizer, which I'm going to discuss very quickly. I encourage again, refer to your vegetable guides. They have most of the information that you'll need. For some reason, my header didn't appear on the top. This is a slide of vegetables that we can plant quite easily here in Southwest Florida. The left-hand column is cool season crops, warm season crops. The right-hand column is cool season crops. When I say warm season crops, I'm not meaning July and August. That they can be grown in very hot weather where the temperature is 90 degrees and relative humidity is 50-60%. But they are placed under stress because of the very strong sun that you well know we have here in Southwest Florida. Generally speaking, they're plants that you can have in your garden planted right now. My gardens have all of those plants all growing right now. The right-hand column are cool season crops. They appreciate growing between 50 and 75 degrees. If the temperature gets up closer to 90 degrees, if it's not a transplant that's well established, it is put under severe stress because of the intensity of the sun and the temperatures that we still are experiencing now, high 80s to 90 degrees. Those crops I haven't planted yet. I won't plant those until the middle of October. Once our temperatures stay down below 90 degrees, and we had evening temperatures that dropped down to 70, maybe 65, those crops will do very well for you. And they all grow very well here. Because we have an extended period of time from mid-October all the way through until April, May timeframe. So you've got 6 months in which you can grow any of those crops. And typically all those crops, from the radish at over 25 or 30 days to your cabbage and your broccoli, which will take 90 to 100 days to mature to, say, so you have a house to grow. you can easily grow those within our cool season. Matter of fact, we'll talk a little bit about later, you can grow two crops. You can have a succession plan, planting of your crop, and harvest, especially the lettuce and the radishes and collards and the leafy vegetables. You can get two crops in very easily, starting in this month, in the middle of October, and proceeding forward. A little bit about soil preparation. Your garden beds are prepared, excellent soil in them. They've been amended with some fine mulch and organic materials such that, generally speaking, there's no real additional amendments that you need to place to your soil the first year that you're gardening. For those that have been in the program for a year, there's a little amendment that can be added just to supplement the soil and to help replace those nutrients that have been used in previous growing. Very important in any garden that you're growing is to keep your garden free of weeds. We'll talk about weeds some more. And keep it clear of all debris. The reason? The debris is a home for all of your insects. And although 90% of the insects that we have here are beneficial, they're going to help in one way or another in your garden. But that 10% that's not beneficial, they love to find a home in debris, in anything that's laying around that's decaying, etc. They will they'll find that as a home. If you have that debris, then you are providing an environment that may make your success in the gardening process a little more difficult. You will not need to amend your soil with organic matter in the first year. In the second year, a bag of 0.5 nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, composted cow manure, applied at only 1/2 inch on top of your garden bed, and then tilled in 3 or 4 inches, is primarily all of the additional nutrients you will need to add to this soil. The soil is very good that you have here in the garden beds. It's important in that it brings back up to the surface any soil-borne insects and pathogens that may be in the soil and gets them exposed to that nice big sun that we've got up here. And the sun will take care of killing those pathogens and insecticides that may come up to, including you'll kill weed seeds. And it also will create an opportunity for the weed seed to germinate, and you unfortunately need to keep weeding all the time. The soil has been tested for acidity and alkalinity, and the nutrient content is very high in the soil. The soil pH is a little high, that's been provided in your beds. The pH tested out at 7.8. Typically, most vegetables like to grow between a pH of 6.5 and 7.0. We have suggested that prior to starting your garden bed, and even you can add it to now, if you're already growing, that you add a soil acidifier to the soil. Soil acidifiers typically are compounds that are use organic products, sulfur being the base. Sulfur nitrate is the normal product that's added. Typically, a soil acidifier that's used for rhododendrons, azaleas, blueberries, will be quite adequate for you. Sulfur is a compound that breaks down quite quickly and will leach through the soil if over applied. Be sure to follow the instructions on the bag of acidifier that you use. And do not over apply the acidifier. Better to do frequent applications once every 3 months. And that's about the length of time that it will take for the sulfur to start to have an impact in lowering the pH. We need to have the soil for our Briscoe gardens slightly on the acidic side. And unfortunately, the soil that was pushed into the beds is a little on the alkaline side. When planting your garden, some things to consider. Use fresh seed. Yes, I know that, and I do. I collect seed and use it for the next year. But if you want to have great success, you want to plant fresh seed, you know that it's been tested, know it will germinate well, and will not give you any disappointment. There are some seeds that are sent to you that have been treated. And they're treated with a fungicide to prevent soil borne diseases from attacking the germination of the seed and subsequently its growing. Fortunately today, our nurseries and laboratories have done many tests and developed many varieties that are pest resistant. An example, tomatoes. Everyone wants to grow a tomato, love to have, love and taste the fresh tomato. When you purchase a tomato seed, there's a VFN resistant, and that's just a abbreviation for verticillin fusarium resistant varieties. Those are funguses that attack a plant and the soil-borne carry diseases. Read your directions and your descriptions carefully about each plant that you're growing, and reading the brochures that you've been given, you'll get a real good indication of what you need to be looking for in terms of your seed selection. A little bit more about planting. I recognize, as it was last year, and this is the fourth time I've given this class now, many of the gardeners that we have out at History Park have had some exposure and some end to doing some type of gardening effort, whether it be growing something in a container, or they had a little plot that they were growing some vegetables or some flowers. For those of you that may be approaching for the first time, and we had certainly had some of those last year, and they have really done very well with just a little bit of attention to the initial preparation of the bed and the planting of the seed. We had one lady from Chicago last year that had never had a seed or a trowel in her hand. She had never done any type of gardening. And it's really rewarding to look and see and how happy she was to be tasting her tomato at Christmas time. It was really, really, the smile on her face was wonderful. In the preparation of your bed, some of this is just really good old-fashioned common sense, but you don't want hills and valleys in it where you can have a collection of water buildup, etc. Just rake it out smooth and nice and level, and then sow your seed. That's rather a broadcast, sow the seed, that's a broadcast picture. Yeah, I know you're all going to want to count your seed and place one here, and here, and here, and one here. You don't really need to be quite that exact with the application. Just sow the seed in the soil. If it all germinates and all comes up, then you have to have no mercy. No mercy. You can't save every one of your plants, and you have to remove and get the proper spacing, as is on the guideline in the packet of seeds that you have. If it says place, grow each plant, you're going to grow a bee. Grow one, place one seed every 3 inches. Well, that's a very tedious time where you do it. Just sprinkle the seed down the furrow and cover it up, tamp it down, and when it comes up, pull out and get one every 3 inches. Thin the seedlings to the recommended spacing. And that's quite important. You need to have space between plants so that one is not robbing the other of nutrients and moisture. And it gives it adequate space that it can grow and not overshadow its neighbor. This is just kind of common sense things that do help in the growing of your vegetables. When you're planting your seeds, common mistake is to plant the seed too deep. If you're going to err in any way, make the error on not planting it deep enough. Overplanting, planting it too deep, the seed may germinate under the surface, but it's going to really struggle to get to the surface and get to light and to grow. Obviously, seed is varies greatly in the size of the seed, and I use a couple of examples here. Lettuce is a very fine seed, and there's probably in one little packet you probably got 500 seeds in that packet. Lettuce needs light in order to germinate. If it's planted too deep, it will not make it to the surface and start to grow. Maximum a quarter inch deep. No, I almost surface and sow my lettuce. I literally prepare the soil, sprinkle the seed, and then I just take the back of my hand and go. There's enough seed when you're planting it. Don't put it real thick, but this thin link. I'll apply it. Just tap the back of your hand, and there's enough seed that would be tamped into the soil that you will have many, many more lettuce plants than you want in one spot, and you will need to thin. On the contrast, squashes have one of the larger seeds, and they need to establish a root system real quick. They have a lot of energy within the seed and the seed coat and the embryo, and they will send up a sprout with no problem. It's got lots of strength within the seed. And start growing almost immediately. You should plant those at least an inch deep. It gives a chance for the plant to be able to absorb the seedling to absorb moisture. They are susceptible to soil that's too dry on the surface. And we'll talk a little bit more about that just a minute when we get to irrigation. Some tips in planting and in growing your vegetables. Think up, especially with anyone who's growing in a container or in a plot that doesn't have a half an acre in which to, you know, be able to spread everything out and have lots of space between your garden beds and each vegetable. Thinking up is a very, very good way of getting a maximum amount of fruit from your crop in the minimum amount of space. Green beans are very good at for trellising, peas, even any of your vegetables that tend to grow, that have tend to be viney, cucumbers, your melons, all can be grown vertically on a trellis. The heavier fruits, like your melons, etc., as it climbs up and starts to set the fruit, then you need to, well, for the husband, he goes to and gets some pantyhose from his wife, or you go and you get one of your old pantyhose and you create a little cradle for your melon and you tie it to the trellis and it continues to grow and produce. You want to keep the fruit up off the ground. It's less susceptible to any soil-borne diseases, and the fruit remains nice and clean for your eating. I lost my words. Don't know what happened with that one. There's numerous techniques that you can use when you're planting in the garden bed. This one is just showing you that you have a one type crop fully filling the garden row. As it matures, that particular one, you probably would not thin it. As you do start to thin it, you're eating it, and you're giving more space for the other plants to grow. Being a leafy vegetable, that's the best technique. One of the things that you can do as you have a bed that is 10 feet long and 4 feet wide is that you can interplant. You can plant a long season, a plant that takes a long time to grow, with one that only takes maybe 40 to 50 days. Carrots and radishes is an example. Lettuces being planted amongst the carrots, etc., is another example. And by the time that the carrots are ready to be picked, you will have already eaten all the radishes or lettuce and be replanted again, as it turns out, because that's an excellent succession plant, radishes and leafy vegetables. Generally, you should be in your garden bed beginning two crops during the normal season from your leafy vegetables. Here at History Park, with the size of the plot you have, most likely, unless you're really, really a great fan of just eating corn, you won't be planting corn in your bed. It takes up too much space. But if you have the opportunity to plant corn, you can do some intensive gardening practices by planting a crop that appreciates a little bit of shade from the hot sun, and plant it underneath, in this case, corn, which is going to grow and it's quite leafy, and will provide a nice environment for the lettuce that's growing underneath. So you're just planting a tall crop with a short crop underneath it. You can use your corn as a trellis rather than using netting and setting up that type of arrangement. You can let the pole beans just curl right around the corn. Won't have any impact upon the corn crop that you have, and you'll utilize the space to the maximum extent. Succession plant. Those on the left are mature. You see the tassels already set, and we're getting ready to set the ears of corn. Those on the right were planted 2 to 3 weeks later, and in doing that, then you've got a continuous supply of vegetables going on down the calendar. I'm going to talk quite a bit now about irrigation, fertilization, and mulching, and subsequent to that, some pest management principles. Probably one of the things that early on, after you've planted your seed and it has come up, almost on a daily basis, you need to be checking that you have adequate moisture in the soil. Nothing is going to be a greater detriment to growing your vegetables. It is lack of water. The frequency in which you irrigate, that you do watering, really depends, well, one on the environment. Obviously, if you are growing some things in the summertime, we get frequent rain. And so most likely, supplemental watering is not really going to be necessary unless you have a very new seedling just starting to grow. And if you do, you need to be watering it almost every day. The sun is so strong that it will dry out the first inch or two of soil within a day or so. It just evaporates, it disappears. You know, where did it go? Well, it evaporated, and you just didn't realize it. Once the plant is established and it's growing, at minimum, your plants need to have 1 inch of water per week. And that's not 1 inch on Sunday and then wait until Saturday to do it again. That's a small amount of water placed frequently to keep the surface of the soil relatively moist. Young seedlings just starting to grow, need to have a continuous supply of moisture. Once your plant is mature and it has several leaves growing on the plant, you can apply water less often, but a greater quantity. What we're looking for there is your plant is growing, it's establishing a root system, and the root system is seeking water. So if you give it a thorough watering, 1 inch of water every 3 or 4 days, and your plant will survive quite well. Better to water less frequently in a greater quantity. That allows the water to soak into the soil and your roots to go seeking that water. As they're seeking it, they're expanding, they're growing, and they're becoming stronger. If you water every day, the roots stay up close to the surface because the water's right there. And so your strength of your plant is not as strong because the roots have not proceeded to go down to where the water is. And the water in our soil here in Florida will drain through the soil very quickly. Oh, by the way, all the soil in Florida is classified as Miaca sand. It's naturally doesn't have a lot of nutrients, organic matter in it. And so it drains very frequently. And unfortunately for our environment, we'll talk about it with fertilizing in a minute. Unfortunately with our environment, it will leach all of your nutrients through the soil quite quickly. You know, one of the